Okay, in terms of the stuff, the deadlines remain, well, same except for the change, which I guess is true of everything. Everything remains the same except for what changes. So, as I mentioned before, the quizzes for 3, 4, and 5 extended to September 29th because of the storm vacation, so they were extended 5. Exam 1, quizzes part 2, deadline remains October 20th. Exam 2, quizzes part 3, November 17th. Exam 3, exam 4, quizzes part 4, December 8th. And these are all end of day. For the paper draft, if you wish to do one, you do as many as you wish, where 0 is among the numbers you can wish for, and that is November 12th. And you can do as many as you want, either time runs out, you can take the process so you get the grades you want and upload that to Blackboard. You get the +5 bonus for being on time. Be sure to upload it by November 15th, end of day. If you need another week or something bad happens, or something good happens, November 22nd, full credit deadline, and December 8th, the desperation deadline for half credit. Before pressing on to finishing up our good dead friend Aristotle, anything about any previous stuff or stuff to be, or other stuff that needs more stuff? It's all about this stuff. Which is also a very bad movie about killer yogurt. It's on IMDb, I'm sure it got like 2 or 3 out of 10.
Yogurt.
Evil yogurt, the stuff. If you watch it, it'll change your view of yogurt. Or maybe not, maybe you already hate yogurt. Okay, so last time looking at a good day for Aristotle, talking about first principles, looking at the first principles. Now he claims there's two sets of first principles. Those are the sciences, including the fundamental principles and definitions of the sciences, including math, medicine, physics, and even ethics. If you take the PHI 3601 class, you'll see that Aristotle thought ethics was a science. There are also the first principles of logic, and these are, for him, fundamental to all reason. So if you're thinking about anything, you're using those principles of logic. Now, these have been established as, not surprisingly, basic principles of logic. You take a logic class, you will see either these being, you know, endorsed explicitly or challenged. First, the classic law of non-contradiction, which is, of course, that A cannot be good with B and not B. And it's something that is generally accepted. So today cannot be both Monday and not Monday. Now, it does run into some interesting problems which are hacked at by later philosophers, such as, I think it's something like having colors. For, you know, if you have a shirt that's multicolored, it can be both, say, purple and red. Or like the backpack is both black and not black. It's also gray. And then you run into sort of like, how do you sort that out? But it seems like, laying aside problems like that, which are interesting problems, is that it does seem to be true. In the normal course of logic, A cannot be both B and not B. And it's a fundamental basis for logic even today. Second, the law of excluded middle. A must be either B or not B. Everything either is something or is not something. Today is either, must either be Monday or not Monday. The backpack must be black or not black. And again, there are those that debate that. There's some logics that reject excluded middle. Now, you do then, of course, run into some interesting or non-interesting questions about like blended stuff. You know, could something be both beautiful and not beautiful? Which is something Plato says. And is that actually combining two things that are, you know, contradicting each other? Or is that, you know, is a blend of, you know, beauty and not beauty just a thing of its own? Lastly, the law of identity, which is a basic law of logic, the most basic of all, A is A. Each thing is what it is and not some other thing. So those seem reasonable. Is everything what it is? Seems true. Everything is what it is. If it was something else, it wouldn't be that. So, looks good. Now, he claims that these principles describe not only thought, so it's not just the logic of us thinking about stuff and posing on reality like a projector projecting onto the screen, but also composes reality. that reality works like this. And that itself is something, as you might imagine, philosophers and scientists still debate. Do these thought, language, and reality match up? Can you go from one to the other? And of course, the main answers are yes and no, depending on who you talk to. And so the reason why this connects into metaphysics is because, again, it's not just a question of, like, you thinking this and talking this, he thinks this is how reality works. Now, to get explicitly into his metaphysics, he called metaphysics first philosophy. And I mentioned back in the ancient days, at the start of the course in the before time, that the reason why metaphysics is called metaphysics is because someone has organized a collection of Aristotle's works, and they didn't have a name for the next book. And so they had a book called Physics, and they say, hey, let's call the book after Physics the book after Physics, the original. And it stuck. So that's where it came from. And if it had been, if Aristotle had written a cooking book, it would have been, if that was there, it would have been after cooking. We'd be talking about meta-cooking, which we can still talk about. You know, so that would be like not only cooking, but like really awesome cooking, meta-food. Now, Aristotle made a large chunk of his career being critical of his mentor, Plato. And the main thing that he disagreed with him on were those forms. As you might recall from the ancient days, Plato believed that these forms, these universals, existed not here. So they're in the Platonic heaven, outside of space and time. Each one is singular, perfect, changeless, eternal, and it makes each thing what it is. So, you know, we're human, and so in the Platonic heaven, there's the form of human that is perfect, unchanging, eternal, and makes us all human. So Plato's view is they have these qualities, perfect, unchanging, eternal, and the particulars, that is to say us, we are imperfect, changing, and unfortunately mortal. We have an expiration date. So how did Aristotle criticize these forms? Well, lots of criticisms. Because Aristotle, very thorough guy. One thing that shaped Western philosophy was the Greek approach to argument, where you argue everything and in great detail. And so one of the hallmarks of sort of Western Greek originating philosophy is lots of arguments. They also brought about the idea of, like, you know, complicated laws and argumentation. So law. So some good stuff, philosophy, some bad stuff. First concern, explanatory power and complexity. Aristotle says, hey, although the forms seem kind of cool, existing up there in Platonic hyperspace, they lack explanatory power. And if you recall back to the beginning, one of the ways you assess a metaphysical theory is, does it explain stuff? Now again, going back to the analogy, buying metaphysical theory is kind of like buying a phone or a car or anything. You look at, like, the negatives and the positives. And just like if you have a phone, you want a phone that's, well, I guess phony is actually pretty low on the list. You want a phone that's like a good camera or can run apps really well. And so a good metaphysical theory has got to explain stuff. And Aristotle says, these things don't explain the natural world. Or so he claims. Now, Plato thinks they do. But Aristotle says, you know, if you want to know, like, what is to be human, saying there's some hyperspace form doing stuff doesn't help. In fact, he says it's worse than not explaining stuff. It also creates a second realm that you need to explain. So not only does it explain the stuff here, he creates like a whole area that has to explain too. So doesn't explain stuff here, and it creates another problem. So what he ends up with, instead of explaining things and creating a unity that accounts for everything, he ends up with an additional multiplicity. So basically his main criticisms are, one, those forms don't explain anything here. Two, they make things worse because they don't explain, and you also got more things to explain, namely the forms. And so they are bad, or so he claims. Next problem, the problem of change and movement. Now he claims the forms don't seem to contribute anything to the particulars. So the question would be like, okay, we're human, supposedly because we participate in the form of human, but how does that work? So why don't they cause change and movement in particulars? Well, there's the reason. Do the forms change?
No.
No, and so it means they can't do stuff. They seem to be like inert. So he ends up in kind of a problem, because if their change is eternal, blah, 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 then they don't do anything. Because doing and quantum involves changing. You're doing stuff, and you're doing more stuff, and you're not doing stuff. So he claims, and it's typical Aristotle, you know, drama, that the whole study of nature has been annihilated. Because if the forms supposedly explain everything, then they explain nothing here, so all that is gone. Now, other thinkers might be content with, you know, only two criticisms of Plato, but Aristotle was nothing but thorough. As you might recall, Aristotle had a set of categories including substance. And he claims that since the forms are not here, they can't be the essence of a thing, and they can't be the substance of a thing. So the question would be is, what do they do? What do they contribute? And his answer is nothing. They contribute nothing. Also, like we saw before, participation is a mystery. Another one of the problems potentially with metaphysical theories is being mysterious. And Aristotle says, this is mysterious, that this talk of participation or imitation, again to use an Aristotle quote, is to use empty words and poetical metaphors. So they do nothing. They also brought the third man, which you saw before, you know, the regress, but wait, there's more. Before going to more, anything about this that needs more? So, if there's all those problems, what's his solution? Well, one of the common methods of philosophy, and typically if anybody's thinking about going to grad school, great choice, one of the typical ways you do a dissertation is you spend like a big chunk of dissertation looking at the literature of the field, as I say, all the people who came before you, some of which are probably dead, hopefully not all of them, and then you say why they're all wrong, because your project is to add something new to the body of knowledge, so that involves saying why everyone else got things wrong or didn't get things entirely right, then you say why you're right. And so Aristotle's doing the same type of deal. He's gone and saying, okay, Plato's got all this stuff wrong, so now he's going to show what is the right answer. Because it's one thing to sort of tear things down and say everything's wrong, it's quite another to put something in its place. And it's similarly also a problem like in science and politics. If someone's in politics and they're just tearing up the existing stuff and throwing it out, that's all potentially well and good, but you got to put something in its place. So what does he put in its place?
Is that all types of philosophy? PhDs.
Pretty much, yeah, because the standard in the field is you get a survey of literature, so basically you got to go through and grind through all the reading, and then, you know, put all those fat footnotes in there, get to fill those footnotes, got to have them, and then you got to do the survey of the literature, then you bring in your new thing. You typically criticize what came before you, bring in your new thing, show your new thing, solve the problem, and then you submit it, and then you graduate. Hopefully. And lots of footnotes. So what he does is this. He pulls the forms out of hyperspace and brings them down here. You know, again, going back to the famous Society of Athens picture, Plato's pointing up, Aristotle's pointing down, and he's bringing the forms down to Earth. So Plato had what were called transcendent universals, or TU, if you like to abbreviate this. And they're transcendent because they transcend here. They're not here hanging out with us. You can't find them, you know, down at Starbucks or even, you know, alternative places for people who hate corporate culture, except Starbucks. They're not here. They're out in Platonic hyperspace, which is kind of nowhere. And Aristotle, as we saw, says that's crazy talk. So what we do is we get a new form of crazy talk, and he brings forth what are called immanent universals, or IUs, as one might wish to call them, and they're here. So where are the universals for Aristotle?
here,
all around you. They come out at night, mostly. So they're all over the place. If you're looking around, you're seeing, they're seeing you.
How does Aristotle defend the position that the forms have substance here, and that there's an essence here? How does he do that?
Oh, yeah, good question. What he says is that what we got basically going on is everything is built out of these substances, you know, things that are like, I'm a substance, you're a substance, we're all making up reality. We're doing our part. So if anybody says you're not doing your part, you can tell them, I'm doing my part because I'm contributing to reality every day. And that's true. But the way it makes it up is, every, like an individual like me or you, we have a set of all these qualities, and so the universals, the properties, make up like parts of us. So all the qualities you have, like your list of ingredients or qualities, is consist of those universals in a sense, and all of them together plus that substance, you know, all those qualities that are stuck on top of that, however that works, that would be you. So we're all, we've all are instantiating those immanent universals here. They don't exist apart from us, they exist as part of us. They're all components of us. So we're basically, everything that exists is a substance, plus all those properties that are the universals. You can go, I usually use the Mr. Potato Head metaphor, but now I'll go with the pizza metaphor. Think of like the pizza crust as like the substance, and then all the sauce and the cheese and toppings on top of it, those would be all the qualities. We are like the pizzas of the universe. And of course, pizza is a metaphor for pizza too. But pizza is also pizza in this metaphor. Yeah, so reality is just a big collection of entities, particular entities with qualities. Now, he brings up two concepts such that people have inquired, is that a real word? What is a fair point? Whatness and thisness. And I guess, yeah, I guess they kind of are real words. Now, everything's got a whatness and a thisness. A thing's whatness is this. That's the properties that each substance has got. It makes it what it is in terms of its types. So like my whatness and your whatness, we share humanness. So if someone says, what are, you know, the answer would be, one answer would be we're humans because of our, you know, humanness, because of that quality. And so it's what groups us into types. So like cats would have, you know, Katniss, which is also the star of the Hunger Games. I guess she's a universal of some kind. And so the whiteness is the properties that something possesses, and it answers the question, what type of thing is that? And it's whiteness, you know, things would have lots of whitenesses, you know, human, you know, mammal, biped, space-time entity, etc. Now, our whiteness is what groups us, it's not what individuates us. So the whiteness answers the question, what kind of thing is the thing? And that is given in terms of those qualities. So what makes us individually what we are? Well, that's the thisness. And thisness is what individuates the thing. It's what makes it distinct from all others of the same type. So the oneness would be the qualities that make you of that, of types, group you into categories. The thisness is what separates you from all other things. And so a complete definition of an entity would include both its oneness, what kind of thing is it, and also its thisness, what separates it from all other things. Now for Aristotle, here's how this works. The oneness of a thing is its form. The universals. Those are the properties. You know, the thing is human. The backpack is, well, backpack. Gray, black, having a certain mass. And it would fall into those categories of like backpack, gray thing, thing with mass, thing with books in it. Actually, there's no books in it. Things with stuff in it. Now, the thisness is the matter. So for Aristotle, you are your matter, like the distinct thing. Going back to the pizza analogy, you are the crust. That's what separates you from the other pizzas.
So
And so what he claims is, you know, each of us is a material entity with all these properties stuck on it. You know, if you want to use a pizza metaphor, put on the crust, and that's what separates us. Human because of the property humanness, but I'm me because of my distinct matter. That's what makes me separate from all the things. I'm not you because my matter is different. You're not me, same reason. Or so he claims. And that becomes, you know, or is a fundamental question, you know, in metaphysics, actually life in general. What groups me into everything else and what makes me distinct from, what makes me, distinct from all things? And the answer, of course, is pizza. It's always pizza. Now, it also brings up the notion of function and form. Everyone's heard the idea that, you know, form is based on function. In a way, Aristotle kind of originated that in a way. So the way he defines the form of things is based on what a thing does. Because, as I mentioned before, Aristotle is one of those teleology guys. Everything has a purpose or function. It's a meaningful universe. So what a thing does determines, you know, how it, you know, well, actually what it does makes it what it is. To, you know, to be is to do. Aristotle's saying. And of course there's a musician who says doobie doobie doo, I think. Some musician. And there's also of course Scooby Dooby Doo, which has nothing to do with either of these things, but it's fun to say. So the form then is the essence of a thing, the set of properties that make it what it is. Now, so Aristotle's got, you know, whatness being in a particular category. There's thisness, what it individuates things from all the things, why you are the individual you are, and then he also throws in the notion of essence. So you've got both individuation, which is a function of matter, and then of course you also have the essence. So this is kind of complicated. So like with all complicated things, bad God always helps. So like what would be for Aristotle like a person? Well, you would have the initial matter, and then it would be formed, you know, by the universals into, you know, human shape. And then, of course, each entity, each person would have their essence. That would be the set of properties that are unique to that entity, that make it that person. So what makes you distinct from all the things would be the matter. Because it's only, it can't be duplicated. And you have the set of properties, but the essential set of properties would be the ones that if they changed, you would no longer be the same you. And they're essential in the sense that if you lost them, you wouldn't be you anymore. And Aristotle distinguishes between what's called essential properties, which are things that if you lost those, you wouldn't be that type of thing anymore. You'd be out of that category. And accidental properties, such that if you change those, you still remain in, you know, your categories. For example, and he calls them accidental. The accidental ones are ones you can lose without losing your membership in the categories or particular categories. By accidental, he doesn't mean the sense that they're just there by accident. You know, like two cars collided, you know, because someone's not looking. Essential are ones that if you were to lose those, you wouldn't be that thing type of thing anymore. Accidental as such, you can change them, and you can still stay that type of thing. So for example, take being a person. Now there'd be some qualities that are essential to that, that if you lost those, you wouldn't be a person anymore. And there's one of the big questions in metaphysics is, what are those qualities? What do you have to still be a person? And one thing that people often put in there is you got to be able to think. It, you know, what separates people from, say, rocks is thinking. And if somehow someone lost the ability to think, they would cease to be a person. Now, there are some qualities that are not essential to being a person. You can lose them or change them and still be a person. For example, length of hair. You know, when you cut your hair, you change your qualities, but you don't cease to be a person, I would assume. If you you know, change your clothes. You change something about yourself and your qualities, but you don't cease to be a person. Another illustration, much more simple, would be like a triangle. Is it essential to being a triangle to be a certain size? Or can you have, or can triangles be in theory any size? Like, are these both triangles?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you can expand it or shrink it. And color, you can change the color. It's still a triangle. But if you, what happens if you take away a side? It's still a triangle. No, so the side, having the three sides is essential to being the triangle. Size and color are accidental. You can change those and it's still a triangle. But if you take away a side or add a side, then it's no longer a triangle. So some qualities are essential. If you lose them, you're not that type of thing anymore. You get bumped out of that category. And others are accidental. You can lose them and still be, you know, remain in that category. So you got the matter with the properties on it, like toppings on a pizza, if you, or the, or like things like Mr. Potato Head, whatever metaphor you prefer, or like stuff in the smoothie, where like the yogurt is the matter. And the matter is what individuates that. Now, for Aristotle, we mentioned previously we were talking about the notion of the actual and possible, potential. And for Aristotle, when you have those forms doing whatever it is they do to the matter, they become actualized possibilities. So raw matter, you can use a metaphor like, it's like clay, which can be made into anything. So if you have a, you know, lump of clay, it's potentially anything you can make out of it. And so the matter we've got is potentially anything that can be formed, but of course once it's formed, we're an actualized possibility. So the matter that makes up like me or you was potentially a person, but now it is part of a person. So it goes from possible to actual. So Aristotle believes it's a world of substance or stuff. Now, in addition to the stuff about substance, another key concept about from Aristotle is the notions of potentiality and actuality. And this is later used by following philosophers like our good friend Thomas Aquinas, and of course used endlessly by guidance counselors to this day. Now, one of the things Aristotle has to explain, of course, is change. How does stuff change? We know stuff changes. Well, unless you're Parmenides, then it doesn't, but we believe stuff changes. And he gives the example of an acorn, one of his famous examples. And of course, if you got an acorn, it could be what? Yeah, it could be a tree. It has the potential of being a tree. Now, we now know that's because of, you know, DNA. But Aristotle didn't have the idea of DNA, so how did he explain how this works? And of course, DNA doesn't explain metaphysics, it just explains the physical part of it. So how does it work metaphysically? Well, for Aristotle, change is always going from potentially being something that you're not yet to actually being something. So the acorn is potentially an oak tree. So if it grows into the tree, it's going from a potential oak tree to an actual oak tree. Or if something is cold, it's potentially hot, but if it warms up to become hot, then it's actually hot. So everything is going from it could be something to it becomes that. And then of course it can change back. Now, matter for Aristotle is often presented as pure potentiality. It could be anything, even a book. And again, I always use a metaphor of like, you know, clay or Play-Doh, etc., because you could shape it into anything.
Like a stem cell.
Yeah, good analogy. Yeah, so the stem cells would be a good analogy. They can become any type of cell, sort of like, you know, prime cells. Good analogy. Now, the actuality is then associated with form. You know, using your stem cell analogy and metaphor, they eventually become like a, you know, a heart cell or a brain cell or a liver cell or something along those lines. They become, you know, go from pure potentiality to actuality. So this potential is the capacity to change. So interestingly, and we'll see this later when we talk about God a bit, if you were perfect, you would have no potential at all. Because any change, you can't change, because any change would make you worse. You'd be pure actuality. And having a lot of potential, in a way, looked at that way, means you haven't achieved like lots. So it could be seen as an insult. If someone says you have no potential, that could be the greatest compliment whatsoever, because it would mean you're perfect. That's what I choose to always hear when people say you have no potential. I'm like, yes, perfect. It's all how you hear things. It's a secret to happiness. Now, Aristotle, in addition to his notion of potentiality, something could be something, in actuality, it is something, he came up with four notions of cause, which are rejected now, for the most part, by most thinkers. But it had a huge influence on thought for centuries, and still has influence today, because it's being taught still. And so here is four causes. First is what he calls the material cause. And that is literally the matter that makes up the thing. Now, normally think of causes, we think of to use like a metaphor, like stuff like pushing things or blowing things up, etc. But what he means by cause is kind of a broader notion. Like if you didn't have this, you wouldn't have something else, the effect. And so the matter doesn't like blow up stuff. Well, I guess it can, it's explosive. But if you didn't have the matter, you couldn't have the backpack or the chair. So it's part of the causal process. If you're going to give an explanation of the backpack, you got to bring the matter in as well. Because without the matter, you have no backpack. So material causes are the matter that makes it up. For example, the stone that makes up a statue, and for all things, the base matter that makes all things up. Second is what he calls, or it's translated as, the efficient cause. Now, by this he doesn't mean that it gets like really good gas mileage. It's not efficient in the sense that it's, very low, very effective resource-wise. What he means is the origin of the process that produced the thing. So whatever actualized its potential. For example, the parents would be the efficient cause of a child. The painter would be the efficient cause of the painting. So if we're trying to explain like the backpack, the material cause would be the matter that makes it up, and the efficient cause would be the person.
Somebody in Indonesia.
Yeah, probably some, yeah. Someone probably in Indonesia who put it together. Or maybe a robot, possibly in Indonesia. Third type of cause is what he calls the formal cause, which again may sound like it's like a formal, like a dance or something. What he means is the essence of the thing. This is the form that makes it what it is. So what he's trying to explain is one of the classic problems, to give a concrete illustration, is when humans reproduce, why do they make more humans and not like squirrels or trees? If you plant an acorn, why does an oak tree appear as opposed to like a flamingo? And very few people think, that could happen, but it's a good, in a way, kind of science kind of begins and you ask, like, why does that happen? Why doesn't weird stuff happen? So why does a baby become a human and not like a squirrel? Now today we explain it in terms of DNA. But of course, Aristotle would explain that back then without that. And his answer is the formal cause. Because you have the matter and you have the form that basically ensures that it becomes, if it is able to act on its potential, it becomes that. To use an analogy, you can kind of think of it as like the form is sort of like one of those beach toys, like in the shape of like a castle. And the sand is like the matter. And so if you're an entity growing older, it's like shoveling sand into the mold. Eventually it's going to fill that mold and become that. If you fill the whole mold, you get a castle. So if you have you know, the form of human, you know, attached to that matter, once it grows up, it will be human, not a squirrel. Now, in a way, this explanation still kind of works, because even though Aristotle used the term form, the reason why humans have human kids is because of DNA, which is, you could think of it as the formal cause. It is the, you know, the plan, the architecture of being human. And the reason why, you know, acorns become oak trees is because of their DNA. And Aristotle, again, had no knowledge of, you know, deoxyribonucleic acid, but the basic idea does still hold, that each thing has sort of encoded in it what it is to be. Now, the last one, final cause, is rejected by pretty much all of science today, except, of course, when it comes to do with, like, intelligent beings doing stuff. And that is what Aristotle called the final cause. Again, kind of an odd choice, because we think of maybe, like, final cause being, like, the last, like, you know, final, like, the final conflict or final chapter. What he means by it is this. A final cause of a thing is its end, purpose, or function. In other words, what it is to do. Now, today, if you were to ask, you know, most, you know, scientists, are there final causes, they would say no. Then they'd say, wait, things we make. So when you're trying to explain, say, your smartphone, that's explained in terms of its function. And the objective and the purpose of a smartphone is its function.
All people.
Yeah, one of the functions. But the main one is so you never have to interact with people in real life ever again.
Yeah.
Perfect shield. No people. It's like a magic shield that protects you from personal interaction. It's a beautiful device.
Yeah.
How did people wait in the past? It would, believe me, it was rough. You had to, like, talk to people. That was terrible.
Yeah.
That's terrible, you know, horrible thing. Because all the cool people are on YouTube, not in the world. So, yeah, we do accept that, you know, physical objects we make, computers, obviously, and backpacks and phones and boots and stuff, they do have, like, a final cause because we make them for a purpose or end. But Aristotle believed that this applied not just to manufactured goods, but all natural things, ranging from acorns to rivers to continents to planets to stars to the entire universe. Everything has a purpose or function. Like in the case of the acorn, its function is to become a tree, to make more trees, which is kind of what it does. Now, today, of course, again, if you talk to most scientists who aren't like theists or believers in Aristotle, they would say, yeah, natural things, we can talk loosely about their function or purpose, but they really don't have an end or purpose. They just do what they do. There is no purpose or function or meaning. Now, there is, of course, considerable debate about whether purpose or function requires intelligence behind it. Normally, we think that it does, but you could have purposes or function that are not intelligently, you know, created or guided. So Aristotle, he doesn't, you know, as we'll see, he doesn't believe in, like, a traditional, you know, God that cares and does stuff. You could have a universe that's purposeful, but there is no, like, religion behind it. Okay, so Aristotle, in terms of the question, does everything happen for a reason? And the answer is, well, maybe not everything, but a lot of stuff does. Everything has a goal or a function or purpose. And this also affects his ethics quite strongly. If you take PHI 3601, you'll get to see Aristotle's ethics, which is affected by its metaphysics.
Are there, like, an example of something that doesn't have a purpose or function?
I was trying to think of some people that are useless. No, I'm sorry. Yeah, for Aristotle, I think everything does something.
If I were to describe something by its function, I wouldn't describe it by what it becomes last. I would describe it by what it does first.
Yeah, I mean, that would be, for Aristotle, would be valid too. Like, what is it, you know, what is it, whatever it is that it's doing. You know, because, like, acorns, you know, kind of their final goal is to become a tree and create more acorns, But yeah, they have all their functions too, like squirrel fruit or slingshot ammunition.
Yeah, or just the sprout roots. What do acorns do? They just sprout roots. After that, they're probably not even an acorn anymore.
Yeah, good point. Yeah, but yeah, so yeah, you're right. Once it's sprouting, it's not an acorn. It's a seedling. Yeah. Yeah, so its purpose is to cease to be. Poor acorns. Born to die.
Like everything else.
Yeah, true. I guess that's the final goal. Death. But there's pizza. There's pizza along the way. So if he doesn't believe in sort of what we recognize today as sort of the traditional god of religion, what's he got? Well, what he has as sort of his starter and keeper going is what he calls the unmoved mover. What is later, as we'll see in part two, borrowed or stolen by Aquinas and repurposed, repainted as God. So he believes that the world is a world of ends. There is a final purpose. And so everything is trying to actualize its potential. So they used to have the army used to have the same slogan, be all you can be. And they were basically Aristotelian, because Aristotle would say the same thing. Everything is trying to be all it can be, to actualize its potential. And so matter is just a big collection of potentials. It can be all this stuff. And objects, of course, have this potential to move. And one thing that a couple of the big questions they try to answer in physics and philosophy is, one is, why is there something rather than nothing? Which is a good question. It's one you almost never think about, because you're like, hey, why is there stuff and not stuff? Another one is how does it get moving? I mean, we clearly see that there's stuff and it moves, but a good question is, why is there stuff and why does it move? Now, Aristotle, unlike in many of the philosophers, especially religious thinkers, believes that the universe is eternal. The universe has always been and always shall be. There is no before the beginning of the universe. It's just always been. And that, of course, is one of the big problems in science and philosophy is, was there like a before time? And one end of it doesn't make any sense, because that's before is time. And is the universe like eternal, or is it finite? And pretty much everyone agrees that either is or isn't. That's a safe bet. Either is eternal or it's not. And some people like alternate. I go like depending on the day of the week. Sometimes they say it's eternal, sometimes they say it's not. That way I cover my bets. But Aristotle believed that it is eternal. The universe was not created in the sense we think of as usual creation. So there was no like, in the beginning there was darkness and there's 6 days of creation. Aristotle, the universe has always been. But for him, there is a source of motion for everything. And to argue for this, he uses an infinite regress to show that there must be a mover. And of course, the reasoning, it's later borrowed or stolen by our good dead friend Thomas Aquinas. But basically, the way it works is, if everything had to be moved, then if something moves, something else has to move it. And then somebody has to move that, and somebody has to move that, which means it would go off to infinity. But of course, that's impossible, so nothing would move now. But stuff is moving, so there must be a mover that is not itself moved.
So would you describe that which moves gravity, the Earth?
It would probably be, you would have a series. Like, you could say that Earth, moves things with its gravity, but then the question is, like, where did the Earth get its, get its stuff from, and there always would be something from which the movement comes from, until you get to something, according to Aristotle, that moves everything but is not itself moved. Because otherwise, there would be nothing moving but stuff is moving. Or so he claims. So, what is this unmoved mover like? Well, it's not God for Aristotle. Why? Also doesn't care about us, because if it could care, it could be moved, like in an emotional sense. But it can't be moved, so it doesn't care. So the universe for Aristotle does have a purpose, but it doesn't care about us. But But that's not bad, because the cause is a bad thing.
Okay, so does that mean the mover, move applies in two senses in this term, or is it just one?
Oh, yeah, because it's moving both,
the unmoved.
Yeah, there's emotional moving and physical movement. And Aristotle thinks that the mover is unmoved in all ways. It's not affected by anything. So you can also say that it's the uncaused.
Like Buddha.
Caused. Yeah, in a way. Yeah, Buddha is unmoved by anything when he achieves that perfect nirvana. So it doesn't care. It's unmoving. Now, the unmoved mover is, of course, not in motion. So it's not an efficient cause, because it doesn't start things in motion in the sense of it being moving and moving them. Now here in the world, you can talk about the efficient cause of something's motion. For example, when I move this, I am the efficient cause of its movement. But if you trace it all back to where movement started, Aristotle says the first mover is not itself moving. It does not move itself. It moves all of the things, but is not itself moved. So how does it do this? Well, his answer is, it is the final cause. In other words, all things are trying to be like the unmoved mover. Because it is, unmoved, it's, essentially, crudely put, it's like a perfect being. It is full, it has no potential, it's perfect actuality. So we're trying to be that. We're trying to use, again, the army slogan, we're trying to be all that we can be. So, it's like, to use a metaphor, it's like the finish line. In a way, the cause of people running is that finish line. Or people going to school, one cause is that graduation date. So the graduation, itself is not moved, but it's moving. You're aiming towards it. So it's not an efficient cause, it's a final cause. It's your goal or end. So crudely put, in a way things are like pulled towards the unmoved mover. Like people are pulled towards graduation. So the unmoved mover has got all kinds of stuff going on, and we only have a couple minutes left, so we'll just do a bit of it. Now, the unmoved mover has no unrealized potential. Why? Because it is fully what it is. Second, it doesn't need to change. So what does it do? Well, his answer is, it must engage in the highest of all activities. And for Aristotle, being a philosopher, he claims the highest activity is thought, which is not something everyone agrees with. Some people think it's tweeting is the highest activity, but for him it's thought. And so because of this, in case you wonder, why is there the view that humans are the pinnacle of everything, in part it's just pure ego, we think we're the best, but also you can trace a lot of it back to Aristotle. Because if thought is the highest activity, and we are the only thinking creatures that we know about, we are the highest of creatures. So then, what is the unmoved mover thinking about? Well, it can't be thinking about the particulars because they change. So it would be changing, but it can't do that. So what is it thinking about? Well, its thoughts have to be unchanging and undivided, so it's going to be thinking about that type of stuff, which means it's thinking on its thinking, which is kind of, so it's intelligent, but it's not thinking about us. It doesn't care about us. It's thinking about thinking. Now, the new Platonists really like this idea and kind of ran with it, and so his unmoved mover is kind of an odd entity. It doesn't care about us. It's thinking about thinking. It's not thinking about us or particulars, and it is, pure actuality. And as we'll see later, it's later stolen by Aquinas, repainted as God. So I guess we'll follow our unmoved mover class, and next time we will go to part two, looking at our good dead friend Aquinas. So starting at part two, God, properties, and substance, in reality. Oh.